I am Klaas, and I will talk about ontology engineering methodology. So you already did some ontology engineering in previous weeks for your assignment, and there is also methodology to do this. So you construct an ontology in a structured way with some rules and guidelines. So it is something quite practical. So it's called engineering. So you have all these, so it's basically how to build a proper ontology and having some methodology to do that. It concerns building different types of ontologies. So you have ontologies at different levels of how explicit they are and how detailed they are. And also it's about reuse. So when you're building ontologies, often you'll reuse existing ontology. So this is best practice because there are already lots of ontologies, and then for your specific use case, you will probably be able to reuse one, two, or multiple, many existing ontologies. So before we start with the engineering part, let's see, let's recap what an ontology is. So one of the most accepted definitions is that an ontology is an explicit specification of a shared conceptualization that holds in a particular context. So explicit specification, explicit meaning that you have a formal machine interpretable language, and RDFS and OWL are machine interpretable. Then shared, so you share it between people, you have consensus, and you share it on the web, and you have this meta model to describe the data that you are sharing, that the ontology is about. Sharing, we do it by URIs, the AAA principle, which is authentication, authorization, and accounting. And then if people don't like ontology, they can build their own and they can comment on it. A conceptualization, so you have concepts, and you order them and you model them in a certain way that they become explicit, that you have a description of the concepts in a certain domain. So we have we can work with classes, instances, and relationships between instances. And then when we do this conceptualization, when we classify certain things in a certain way, we have design decisions. And this is also what ontology engineering methodology is about. You have certain reasons to have some classifications or not classify something in a certain way, because there are pros and cons to modeling an ontology in different ways. And then an ontology holds in a particular context. So it is the context being a domain for which the ontology is built and a task for which the ontology is used. So for example, you have a domain geography, and the task in that domain is to give people information about travel times, or give them information about how cities are interconnected. So task is about the scope, what you want to do with the ontology. And then you can make a very large ontology to describe every possible exception and thing. But in ontology engineering methodology, we usually say that you have to take a very lot of care how much commitment you have, how heavy your ontology basically is. So if it's very restrictive, then it is hard to extend, and it might not be correct because domains also change. So we strive for minimal ontological commitment, so only model a domain to such an extent that is necessary for what you're trying to achieve, for your task basically, for your scope. So why do we build ontologies? we can communicate between people, and software agents can interpret the ontology and reason with it. So we've seen that in previous slide that the ontologies are machine interpretable, because we want to make the ontology specification explicit in such a way that, that even machines can interpret it, so very formal. We allow, so you have domain experts that know about the domain, know about the concepts in the domain, and using an ontology we can model this domain knowledge and we can reuse it because other people can then download your ontology. So we make domain knowledge explicit. And we can then use it to analyze instances in a domain. We can have certain rules and axioms, and then if we instantiate an ontology, we can see if the ontology is correct or if something, some data in the domain is incorrect. So an ontology, building it is not a goal in itself. So we have the reasons I just mentioned, these are reasons why you would want to build an ontology. So we either want to have better communication, we want to make software agents talk to each other, and or we want to make domain knowledge explicit and reuse it and analyze it. So we already talked about ontological, yeah, so it's about knowledge sharing and reuse, so that is the goal. So we already talked about ontological commitments. So each statement is a commitment, and if you have many statements, then you might be overcommitting because you describe the world very detailed and very strictly. So we last week we already talked about the open world principle. So people might have new insights, and the world changes. And then if you have overcommitment, then your ontology might become incorrect. And as an example, you have object-oriented models in software engineering, software design, and these are more closed world because the models live in a software system, and software system usually the domain and scope is very limited. You only treat this kind of data, and if the world changes, then the system just doesn't work anymore. But still, the system is still correct in the way it was designed. But ontologies, they talk about the world, which is not often not designed and can change a lot. So the rule of thumb is that you want to have minimal ontological commitments. So and then the domain and range, RDFS domain and RDFS range, which we talked about, I think, 2 weeks ago. They are very dangerous in that if you set a domain in a range for a property, then all subclauses will also inherit that domain in range. So if there is some exception to this domain in range, you'll get an error and it won't work anymore. Or if the world changes and the domain in range don't work anymore, you'll get an error and your ontology is not correct anymore. So they are very restrictive. And then class restrictions, they are in a sense less restrictive because you can have greater detail in which you in which you model the world. So you say a car can only have 4 wheels, and this is then only about the class car. So what about 2 classes, domain and range, and about the property that is often used? So class restrictions are more detailed. So that is something you can take into account when you want to restrict certain things. Then with domain and range you will have higher ontological commitments, and if you can do it with class restrictions, then that'll be better. So we also want to discuss the types of ontologies. Consider them when you want to have minimal ontological commitment. So you only want to support the intended knowledge sharing activities, and then there is both the content and the expressiveness. So we want to the expressiveness is in terms of the ontology and the content in terms of its instantiations. And you have different types of ontologies, and also the ontology engineering methodology that you'll use is some of the different variations are better for different types of ontologies. So there is a table here with three types. So what we call an actual ontology is an ontology, and that is very has very high detail. And we use OWL definitely to model something that is a full-fledged ontology, because OWL is very expressive. But then this has high ontological commitment usually. Then at the lower level is the thesaurus or taxonomy. So thesaurus is about describing things in a dictionary, and a taxonomy is a classification of the things in a domain. So the animal kingdom is a very intuitive taxonomy. So you just classify things as being a mammal, a reptile, or a fish or a land animal, and then that's about it. So that is very simple, and you don't have a lot of rules and regulations and restrictions. And then we do this in SCoS. So SCoS is the Simple Knowledge Organization System. So it is not as expressive as then RDF schema, and then the next level, OWL. So RDF schema, we discussed 2 weeks ago, and it had some limitations in terms of assigning instances to classes, because it didn't have a lot of entailment rules to derive class membership and to specify restrictions for classes and have axioms and such. So RDF schema is good for a vocabulary, so that's like the middle level of detail. So when we do ontology engineering, we talk about classes or concepts. So in the definition, we say an ontology is a conceptualization of a domain. So concepts are classes in an ontology, and then the hierarchy or taxonomy of a certain domain. So you have subclasses and superclasses, then properties, and also property hierarchy, so super and subproperties, which we already discussed in RDFS. But still, it's very relevant to do this properly, because it affects the entire ontology and all the reasoning as well. So you need to have good subclasses and superclasses and subproperties and superproperties. So properties, we have data properties and object properties, or attributes and objects. And also attributes and relationships, or semantic relationships. So these are synonyms, basically, in what we're going to talk about. Then class axioms, which we discussed last week. So disjoint classes, equal classes, restrictions, saying that an instance belongs to a class only if it has a certain cardinality of certain data properties. So a car can only have four wheels, for example. Then we have property types, or so characteristics of properties, domain and range, functional properties, transitive, and property chain, and symmetric properties. So we have lots of stuff to work with. We have an entire toolkit, and then we have the instances, and we also need to do some instantiation to check if our ontology is correct. Yeah, so then there are several methodologies that can be classified in three different approaches. A high-level classification is that you have a top-down, bottom-up, and a middle-out approach. So so before I start explaining middle-out approach, maybe let's first start with top-down. So in the top-down approach, you start with the abstracts, or the conceptual generalized ideas. So maybe you interview a domain expert and you ask what types of classes and instances or concepts do you have in your working domain. And then you work down to the instances. So you first start with classifying and making the properties, and then only you instantiate it. And bottom-up is then looking at specific domain instances. So maybe you take some data file or a story or a book or an interview. You take the text there and you label possible instances of classes and possible relationships between instances. And then these might point to actual classes in your ontology. And there are even automated methods for this. So you take a piece of text and each noun and verb will represent a class and a relationship between a class. And then you, if you have a lot of these nouns and verbs, at some point you'll have something that is probably a class based on that there are many instances in the domain data that you're using. So then you start from the instances, bottom up, and you work your way up there. And then a middle-out approach is something in between. So you both look at generic concepts and at the instances, and you look at both sides, both the schema level and the data level at the same time to construct an ontology. So first we look at the purpose and the scope of an ontology. So the domain and scope basically also. So what do we use the ontology for? For example, we use it for geography. What are the intended users? So we say people from high school, and the purpose is that they learn about geography, that they learn about the countries or city-states or political relationships, those kinds of things. And that's important because it also, if you talk about politics and cities and countries, you already have three classes that probably need to go into your ontology. So determining the purpose and the scope is also useful for thinking about the conceptual level of your ontology, but also what possible instances are in there. So you already know that that instances of cities will be in there and they have certain characteristics. So you can already think about these things. So then you capture what will be in the ontology. So the key concepts and relationships, you start working from the generic purpose and scope, and then you start down designing the actual use of the application. You give a very precise definition of classes and instances and relationships. So you when you decide on terms in the middle-out approach, you start with more fundamental concepts. City, country, then move to more abstract concepts. So in our example, we would say something more abstract is a city-state, for example, or a government, or a subcontinent. So a country is less abstract because we know many instances of countries, and then subcontinents are a bit abstract. Yeah. Then we do coding in the terms, in the sense that we choose the language. So in previous slide, we saw that you have different languages for different types of ontologies. So if it's very expressive, we use AL, and if it's very simple, then we use SCoS, and in between we use RDF schema. And then, so we had this text definition of the ontology, or maybe we have a drawing and a text definition. And then we translate this into formal statements. So for OWL and RDFS, we can use Proto-J, or we can just type text in Turtle syntax, which is more troublesome. And we also have other tools to do this. So we will get a .OWL or .RDF file in Turtle notation, for example. Then also always look for reuse. So when you capture and code and you talk about, for example, geography, there are many existing ontologies. For example, geonames can be reused, so you don't have to do all the domain modeling and all the thinking by yourself. So there might be existing ontologies or vocabularies that can be partially reused. So probably you don't need everything from geonames to make an ontology for geography, but at least some part of it is very useful. And also another added advantage is that if you use your names, then other people will know what you're talking about, because many other people use this ontology. So then your ontology will be even easier to share and understand for other people. And then you basically say, well, we have this ontology, we have certain competency questions. So maybe also when determining purpose and scope, we think, what is the ontology for? We make some questions that the ontology needs to answer. So these are competency questions, and these are also used during evaluation. So this is a very a practical thing to do. So you just list 5 questions that are competency questions, and you say the ontology needs to answer the question, what are the cities that belong to the Netherlands, or what are the cities that are in a country that has a democracy, in our example. And then once you build your ontology, you can use these competency questions to check whether it's correct. And then if it's incorrect, you start over, and so it's an iterative approach, a cyclic approach. You start over until the competency questions can be answered. So maybe you have to add some relationship or clause. So the methodologies, ontology engineering methodologies, are cyclic or iterative. And then document everything. Provide comments and labels also in your ontology itself. So you have RDFS label. So you can then explain in more detail what a class is intended for, because this might not be intuitive from its actual name. Yeah, so for example, you have a class country, which seems pretty intuitive, but a country might be it might not be you might include countries that are not yet officially recognized by the United Nations, or only partially recognized, but then you could still say they're a country. Or what is a continent? So is a you have several definitions of continents in terms of geography, in that they lie on a certain continental shelf, and based on this these opposing views, you might have different countries might be in different continents. So there, with a label, you say this is only about countries according to this, or this is only about continents according to definition XYZ. All right. Also documentation. Document your design decision. So if you decide on having something as a sub and a superclass, then shortly write down why this is a good idea and why there might be some alternative that's not as good as an idea. So we have all these steps. We have domain and scope, reuse. You enumerate the terms, and then you create a class hierarchy. So the taxonomy, you create the properties, so the semantic relationships between classes, and then you actually define them in your RL or RDFS file. Then you instantiate it, check if it's correct, so run the reasoner and check for anomalies. So maybe if you have the actual instances, some rules are violated. And this is not a linear process, because if there are anomalies, then you probably have to go back to a previous step. So this is a lot to work with, and in the next few slides we'll have an example of an ontology that we want to create, and treat these steps in a bit more detail to get you an idea of what you have to do. So determine domain and scope in step one. So in our example, we want to have some application about geography. So this is a screenshot of Google Maps. And then you have countries, cities. So this might be the user interface that we want to recreate. And then we want to make a ontology for a specific domain. But there can be many ontologies about a specific domain. And some of them might be better or worse for doing achieving your task, but no one is correct, because there are many people with many different views, and this is also the strength of the semantic web and linked data, that we make an ontology according to our view, and then other people, they can debate that, or they can have a different view, and you can then connect these two together to give different sides of the coin, of a coin, or to have different views on a certain in a certain domain. Yeah, because we mostly also because we talk about abstractions. So an abstraction is something that's in a sense not real. So this is the way we think about a particular domain, and there are several ways about how you can think about a certain domain. Yeah, so and this abstraction is also based on what we want to do with the ontology. So which use we have for this ontology. And we might anticipate different future extensions to this. So we want to, yes, so this is also something for which we need minimal ontological commitments. If you have very heavy ontological commitments, it's difficult to extend your ontology. So for domain and scope, we have several questions that we can use to go through this step. So what is a domain? What is the use of the ontology? What are the question? What types of question should the ontology answer? So these can be the competency questions that you can check at the end of your ontology engineering cycle, whether they are answered. And also more importantly, or not more importantly, also very importantly, you have to think of your users and the people who will maintain your ontology by adding new data and or modifying data. And these might also have a certain view on a domain, and the users as well. So you have to take into account how they understand a certain domain. So in our example, we say geography, we want to have road planning between between different points on the map or different cities. So possible questions. So these are also the competency questions are, what's the distance between two cities? What sort of connections? So maybe a train, car, bicycling, walking connections. So maybe there's a walking path. Then maybe countries, because if you travel between cities, you do road planning, different countries have different traffic rules, or they have a border crossing in which you need to show your passport. And you need to be ready for that. So when you have a clear definition of your domain and scope, you will also have an idea of the kind of concepts involved and the kind of disciplines, so fields of study. So then you should definitely consider reuse. So that's step two. Because there are many ontologies already out there. And in our example, we have geonames, and we have also DBpedia, which has countries and cities and possible land or sea connections. So there is always, almost always, an ontology from a third party that is useful as a starting point. So you might start with three existing ontologies, and then you add your own classes that are useful for your specific application. So in our example, the route planning. And then once we have a domain and a scope specification, we can talk about terms in this domain. So we have the, for example, we have the competency questions. So we want to know different kinds of connections between cities, want to know about cities and countries and borders. So then we already have borders, countries, connections as terms. And then nouns and noun phrases, these are very useful for identifying classes. So when I talk about, I want to know what cities are in a country, then cities and countries are nouns, and cities and countries are probably also class names. Verbs then are the relationships between classes, and there are also the relationships in the sentence between the nouns, in a sense. So you say what cities are in a country, then are in, is probably a property name. So a city is in a country, and what connections are between two cities. So connections between would be then probably a property name. And then you have tools to do this. Existing knowledge engineering tools, you give them the set of terms, or they generate a set of terms based on some description, and then it proposes a class hierarchy and the properties between classes, the relationships for you. So it does this automatically because it can identify nouns and verbs. So we do this in repertory grid analysis, for example. So nouns and terms, we enumerate them. We have city, country, capital, connection on land, road, border, then railway. So then road and railway, capital, country, and city might be classes. Connection on land and connection on water, they are probably properties, so semantic relationships between them. And then using all these terms, we can think about having a taxonomy. So in terms of taxonomies, we have then again the top-down, bottom-up, and middle-out approach. So then with top-down, we start from the most generic concepts, the most abstract concepts, and we work our way down to concepts that or subclasses that can immediately be instantiated. With bottom-up, we start from the classes that definitely have instances, and then we work our way up to more generic concepts. So and then we need to do some checking, so whether a hierarchy is indeed a taxonomy. So if A is a subclass of B, then every instance of A must also be an instance of B. So instances are also instances of its superclass. So for example, every instance of class dolphin must also be an instance of its superclass mammal. And then we might check whether there are also dolphins that are not mammals. So maybe there are some secret species of dolphins that lays eggs. So with the platypus, this is a difficult distinction to see whether it's a mammal whether it's a bird or a fowl, like a duck. So it's somewhere in between. It has a fur, so it might also be a rodent. So these things we have to check. So then we have property, also class restrictions. And then if the superclass B has class restrictions, then its subclass A will also have these class restrictions. So class restrictions are inherited. So then you might have a superclass that has inherited class restrictions that suddenly do not work anymore, that are invalid, and then there is something wrong. So if you define your properties higher up in the hierarchy, then you will also know that if some class restriction does not hold anymore at a subclass, at a very lower level class, which inherits these restrictions, then either the subclass is not correct, it does not belong to the superclass, there is some problem, or the restriction is incorrect. So your superclass, the restrictions, they do not hold for all subclasses, so it might be the wrong superclass. So these restrictions are also a way of checking whether your domain modeling is correct. So not only checking whether the data is correct, but also whether your taxonomy is correct. So you can have some very basic checks of whether a taxonomy is correct. So you just have you list possible instances, and then you list terms, and then you decide whether something is a class or it's an instance. So in this example, we have Chef, Jamie Oliver, Apple, and Fruit. So then when talking about the difference between classes and instances, a good rule of thumb is saying that an instance can always be identified in the real world with an ID or a name or a birth year. So Jamie Oliver is probably not a class. So it's an instance of chef, because Jamie Oliver is a chef. Then apple and fruit becomes a bit more difficult because there are different types of apples, and apple in itself is not something that, if this is an instance, then it should have an ID. So it could be an instance in a certain recipe, but then you might say that this is apple one or apple with a certain batch number. So apple might be is probably more intuitive as an instance of class fruit. But still, it might be an instance, but this is very unlikely. Or you could list out your hierarchy and then reason about it. So we have things, beverages. Beverages has subclass juices and soda, and then juices there are different types of juices, namely fruit juice and apple. But if you say apple instead of apple juice, then apple might also be reused in another thing, so maybe in some dish, some not a beverage but a meal, then classifying it like this won't make a lot of sense. Also, you can say that you can compare subclasses. So in this case, apple is also a kind of a fruit juice because there are multiple types of fruits, and then apple might also be a subclass of fruit juice. So this is probably incorrect. Another example is having meals. So you have breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And then breakfast has a subclass eggs, lunch had late lunch, and dinner has pasta. Yeah. Well, for example, eggs might also be used during dinner. And there are eggs that might be instances, or the eggs might come back in multiple types of meals. So it might come back in lunch or in dinner. So maybe it's, or probably it's better to classify this as an ingredient for a certain type of breakfast. So, well, for starters, because you know eggs cannot be, can also come back in lunch and dinner, then this is not a correct classification. Otherwise, we will have redundancy in this class. So that then it's not, then it can become a subclass of multiple types of dinner, but then you could have 100 subclasses because in breakfast you can eat almost anything, and then you might have 1,000 subclasses with all different types of ingredients, and then these 1,000 subclasses they come back during lunch. So probably this is better classified as an ingredient and a relationship towards breakfast. So then we have this class hierarchy, and there are multiple ways of again checking if they're correct. So the subsumption relationship is something you have to check for. So if B is a subclass of A, then the set of instances of B is the subset of instances of A. So again, for example, if dolphin is a subclass of mammal, then we need to check whether all instances of dolphins are mammal. So maybe there is some instance of dolphin that secretly lays eggs, and then it's not a mammal anymore. So then it doesn't belong to the instances, the subset of instances of A. And then if we have multiple, so if we have a lot of subclass chains, so B is a subclass of A and C is a subclass of B. So you have A, B, C as A is the superclass, B is a subclass, and C is a subclass. Then we have inheritance, again, inheritance because of the subclass relationship. Then C should also be a subclass of A. So this is a transitive inheritance in a sense. So if you have A, then subclass B, subclass C, then C is also a subclass of A. And that should also hold. And then if you have cycles, so in Protégé you you might define that B is a subclass of A and A is a subclass of B, maybe using some class axiom. Then B and A are considered to be equivalent. And then you can get some very strange results if you run the reasoner. So you need to be careful that if you say that you infer that something is a subclass of another subclass, you might end up with cycles. So then with super and subclasses, we can look at the order dependence of distinctions. So in this example, in this left classification, this left hierarchy, we have superclass infection, then pneumonia, then viral pneumonia and bacterial, and then viral has subclass acute viral and chronic viral. So here all subclasses of viral pneumonia are viral, but only one is acute. And then in a different classification, we say superclass is acute pneumonia because both subclasses are acute, but only one is viral. And this is important because if acute pneumonia would have something that's not acute, then you have a contradiction, or then it's not invalid anymore, because if a subclass is not an acute infection, then only viral, for example, then also by inheritance you have acute pneumonia that are only viral and not acute anymore. So you might have this might be a chronic pneumonia, so then something will be both an instance of acute and chronic, and acute and chronic are probably disjunct. So then because if you you only have a viral here, then you will have a contradiction. So that might happen if you do not take into account that all subclasses are also instances of a superclass. So in our example, we have all the terms and we have a domain and a scope, and then we can create a taxonomy based on all these terms, these nouns and phrases, nouns and verbs. So we might have a taxonomy that says we have different types of connections and we have geographic entities. The connections are then probably connected by a property to the by a relationship to the geographic entities, and we have a subclass hierarchy saying that land connections can be by railway or road, and cities can be capital or industrial. And this might be useful for the application. So one of the competency questions might be, I want to go to a capital city, or I want to go to an industrial city. So we have a hierarchy. So this is in terms of classes and superclasses. And then we also need to think of properties. So the verbs in the in your terms. So verbs and verb phrases, they form the basis for property names. So in our example, the connections, for example, a connection holds, no, so a connection holds between a between two cities, and holds between is the property. So when we do this, we need to think about domain and range. So connection exists between, or connects as a property, would have domain city and range city maybe, or it might have domain city and range connection in air. So with regards to domain and range, you need to consider at what hierarchy level you define a domain and range. So if it's very high at the superclass level, then also all subclasses will inherit this domain and range restriction. So if you, for example, say in our dolphin example, that mammals, the superclass of dolphins, they carry babies. So then the domain of carries babies is mammal, and then the range might be number of babies or types of babies. So the domain carries for carry property carries babies is inherited by from mammal to dolphin. So then you have less flexibility if you do it at the super level. So then you basically restrict that each dolphin must carry babies because it is inherited. But the advantage, so the methodological tension here is that so you lose flexibility if you do it at a high super level, and you gain flexibility if you have the domain and range at the subclass, very low subclass level. But if you, on the other hand, if you define domain and range restriction at a high super level, so at the mammal or animal level, then all subclasses, they inherit it. And if some subclass does not adhere to this domain and range restriction, the reasoner will detect a inconsistency, and you will have, or so then either the instance is incorrectly assigned to a class, or your classification is incorrect. So you have a misconception, your concepts are incorrect. So then both approaches, so at a higher or a lower level, they have advantages and disadvantages. So an example conceptualization of our properties, or in our example about geography, is that we say we have the geographic entities with subclasses country and city, and then city has a subclass capital, and capital is a capital of a country, and a country has a capital. So this is a symmetric relationship, or reflexive. And then geographic entity is connected to different types of connections via the property endpoint and start points, because we want to do route planning. And we might have instances that have multiple start and end points. All right, so now that we have our taxonomy and properties, we can define them in detail in your ontology. When we define classes and properties in details, we can also have a specify a global domain and range for a property, so not specific to a specific class, but we can say that a property must always have a certain data type as its range. So it only applies to integers, or its domain only applies to certain objects. And this is something not yet related to the taxonomy that we created before. So it says something about the entire the use of the property in the entire ontology. So this is something that can additionally be done. And then for properties, we also define that they are functional, inverse functional, symmetric, reflexive, etc. And then we also can say that an instance of a class must always have a certain value for a property. So we can say that every instance of class Fiat has the data property brand name Fiat, for example. Or it can only exist if it has four wheels. So that is something we can then also think about. and these having a car having four wheels is also the next thing we can think about is how many values a property must have to for it to be an instance of a class. So this is what we also discussed last week with class restrictions and subclass of rules. And then we can also look at class axioms to see, for example, if a class or a property is disjoint with another class or property. For example, that an instance cannot be belong to two classes at the same, or a property cannot originate from two properties cannot at the same time originate from a class. And then we ask ourselves, does our taxonomy need revising? And we go back to step one, maybe, to see if we we need to have more competency questions, or if our taxonomy is incorrect in a later step. So for domain and range, we can have multiple options to define a domain and range. And let's practice a little bit with this. So my question to you is, what is a reasonable domain for the property has taste, for the relationship has taste? So the domain is the originating, is where the property originates from. So sweet has taste something, is hotter has taste something, fruit has taste something, food has taste something, and taste has taste something. So which of these is reasonable? All right, so the ones that are not reasonable are is hotter than, because you better have this as a data value with a spiciness index. So you say, so you say that something, some food is spicy one or two or three or four. And having this as a class then does not make sense, because you might have 1,000 instances that say is hotter than something else. And is hotter than has taste also is very intuitive, because taste and hotness are in a sense not very related. So they might have different, they instead maybe we would have a class taste and a class hot food, for example. Then taste as a domain, so taste has taste something, is also not very reasonable. In the sense that taste will probably have instances sweet or sour or something else. So the instances of taste already have a taste or denote a taste. So then having a relationship has taste does not make much sense. All right, then another example is having subproperties. So subproperties, you say that a relationship between two classes is prepares, and then a subproperty is something more specific than prepares. So what would be a reasonable subproperty for prepares? Cooks is okay, because you can prepare by slicing and dicing your food and then cooking your food. So cooking and slicing and dicing, or is job by, would make nice subproperties prepared, because they are all forms of preparation, but more specific. Runs kitchen is less intuitive, because this is something you do during preparation, but also after preparation. So running kitchen might be a super property of preparers. And none of these, well, cooks and is job by might be good, but then again, if you do make these as sub properties, then you have larger ontological commitments. So you should have minimal ontological commitments. So if these are not absolutely necessary for the task that you want to achieve, you better not include them. Then the relationship or the property is eaten with. Is it transitive, symmetric, or functional? So you could say it might be transitive, because if you have an apple that is eaten with an orange, and that orange is always eaten with a lemon, then the apple is eaten with a lemon. So that makes sense, because eaten with says that it should always be eaten with something, should always be eaten with something else. So you can assume that this holds, and then if that other thing is also eaten with something else, this also holds, so then it becomes transitive. Eaten with, according to our previous idea, that if something is eaten with something else, then they are together eaten at the same time. We could also say that this is a symmetrical relationship, so that this is quite feasible. Then for you to think about is whether this is a functional relationship. All right, so let's go to the next slide. So if you need some more help, then just pause the video. So the next step is defining instances. So we have this taxonomy, we have a definition of classes and properties. Then we instantiate the classes, and we instantiate the properties. A good rule of thumb is that you should have more instances than classes. So if you just have a class with one instance, that one instance might also be a subclass instead of an actual instance. And in practice, we do not do this manually if you have many instances. So you have some tools to retrieve instances from databases or from common separated value files, so Excel sheets, for example, or you automatically extract them from text. So yeah, for example, DBpedia Spotlight that has natural language processing and then classifies words as belonging to a class based on how they are used in a sentence. So then once we have these instances, we can do reasoning. So we in Protégé, we have various reasoner. So in this course, we use the palette reasoner. And then AL allows you to detect inconsistencies. So either inconsistencies in an ontology. So even if you do not have instances, your class actions might contradict each other. And then once you have instances, you might again have inconsistencies. Often you have inconsistencies with domain and range for symmetric, transitive, or inverse properties. Because if you have a domain and range definition for a property, and that property is also inverse, then it'll violate the domain and range, because the domain and range is specified in one direction. Cardinality, in the sense that a car only has four wheels. So you might have cars with three wheels, these exist, or you might have cars with six wheels. You might have trucks that have eight wheels, and then if you have instances that are trucks but classified as instances of cars, you have a contradiction. And then also these requirements on property values or cardinality, they can conflict with the main in range. So mostly about you have many inconsistencies about properties. So take care that you check this. So in overview, we have the phases of ontology engineering methodology or ontology development are determining the scope, thinking about existing ontologies. Then when you have a domain in scope, you just list all the terms that are used in your domain and you can see if there is some classes and some class hierarchy, some properties in there. So you look at the nouns and the verbs. Then you, once you have the taxonomy and properties, you explicitly define this and you might have additional global rules or class axioms. Then you define or add the instances. You either do this automatically or you do it manually. And then you run the reasoner and you check for anomalies. And if you have anomalies, you probably have to go back to defining classes and properties or even earlier to properties and taxonomy itself. So then you have these stages, and we already discussed some of the tips that you can use. So you list classes, properties, and instances, so you have a nice overview, and you might also draw a nice diagram to have an overview for yourself. And then if you have a list of classes, you say what are the necessary and sufficient conditioning when using our sum values form and our hash value restrictions. Then you specify additional necessary conditions using any type of restriction. Think about different alternatives, what configuration of individuals are possible, so what how your instances would look like and how you would be able to classify them using different models. Disjoint and complement of classes, they create ontological commitments and they might create contradictions, so use them only sparingly, so do not use them too much. Avoid domain in range in a sense, because again this is ontological commitment and you have many situations in which you can have contradictions because of domain and range. And then specify instances for each class that you write down and see if it works and if it adheres to the necessary and sufficient conditions and the restrictions that you specify. And then always keep in mind that you should have minimal ontological commitments. So you look at what instances will the ontology have and how expressive does it need to be for the task. So sufficient to support the intended knowledge sharing activities. So then we might go for something that is a basic taxonomy instead of a full-fledged ontology with many rules. So that then this determines our choices. So, in summary, you have ontology engineering methodology. If you have a very large ontology, then the use of a methodology becomes more practical because you have a nice framework from which you can work. You need to think about the scope of your ontology, very clearly what your ontology will be used for. You will need maximum agreement between the people that use the ontology, so create a model that is according to their view of the domain, but you do it using the minimum amount of rules or axioms and restrictions and classes, so you only specify what is necessary. So then expressiveness is also about strictness or restrictions. So if you create many restrictions, you have a large ontological commitment. It's nice if you do something very accurate, but you might also get a lot of contradictions and your ontology is also probably less reusable if you have a very strict strict semantics. All right, so many thanks for listening. So this is ontology engineering methodology lecture is something that is useful if you create your ontology, and then later on you also have to integrate your ontology with that of others, and then you can also look back at these rules, see if once you integrate the ontology whether it still makes sense and whether the best practices from ontology engineering methodology still apply. That's it, thanks, and good luck.